Open your Bibles. Oh, man, it's good. It's a good day. Matt, what a great set. Oh, he went to breakfast in the kitchen. Man, that was a really, really good set. That was, it's like he read ahead the next verses and picked the songs accordingly. Title of the message this morning for you in the room and you online, Reconciler of All Things. We're back in Colossians 1. This will be our last message in Colossians 1, so praise the Lord. I mean, you know, three messages a chapter. That's not too bad for me. Colossians 1, verses 19 to 23, here's what we're doing, is we are holding the genuineness of Jesus Christ up and trying to show him to you so clearly that you'll recognize a counterfeit instantly, right? The more you know Jesus and the more you know the truth about Jesus, when you hear something, you're like, that doesn't sound quite right. Like, is there enough Jesus in there? Because, you know, the Bible's like full of Jesus. So that's what we're doing. Last week, great set, Matt. Last week, we looked at the supreme preeminence of Jesus Christ. He is before all things. He is above all things. He is supremely preeminent. And most importantly, he is God in expression to us. He is God expressed to us in man. And so we tried to make it really clear last week that because of who Jesus Christ is and because of what he has truly done, his sacrifice alone can reconcile us to God. There is no other philosophy, ideology, religious, whatever, that can do that. Only Christ alone, because of who he is and what he's done, can reconcile us to God. So to be reconciled, especially with the way this word is used in our text today, it means to bring back to a former state of harmony. That's what reconciled means. It means to bring you back, you know, to where you belong, you know, get back, Jojo. You have to get back to where you belong. You belong in harmony with God. God made you to be in fellowship with him. And Jesus Christ made a way for you to get back to that, to be reconciled. So you have to know that God is the author and the finisher of us being reconciled to him. We did nothing. We can't earn it. We can't deserve it. We can't get there from here. We are without Christ. We are hopeless and helpless to be reconciled to God, but God has made a way in Christ to bring us back to that former state of harmony. On the wall, 2 Corinthians 5:18. I don't have a lot of cross references today, but jot these down in your margin. 2 Corinthians 5:18, it says, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself. Jesus Christ is the reconciler of all things. You ready to hear about it? Okay, let's pray. Lord Jesus, give us ears to hear, Lord. God, give us a heart to receive, Lord. God, not hear as in the physiological hearing. Give us a heart to hear. Lord, reveal yourself to us with power. In your precious name, Jesus, amen. All right, let's start with a little review from last week just to kind of get the ball rolling. It's Colossians 1, verse 19. It's on the wall or preferably in your Bible. And from the NLT, it says, for God in all his fullness, this is really crucial, and I could have gone off completely on what that phrase means. It's so big, but I'll just read it because the NLT does a pretty good job here. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ. God in all his fullness lives in Christ. The word fullness there means inherently full. Like, you know, He came filled. He's always been filled with the fullness of God. And there's a kind of a reference to permanent filling. So he's inherently and permanently filled with all the fullness of God. That means that the Father did not, listen, this is really important, the Father did not give Jesus all the fullness of God. Does that make sense to you? The Father did not pour the fullness of God into Jesus. Jesus is inherently and permanently filled with the fullness of God, right? The fullness of God lives in him inherently and permanently. You might think, why is that a big deal? But it's a huge deal, because when we say God himself reconciled you, we mean in the person of Jesus Christ, you've been reconciled. And so we must see God as the Bible proclaims him to be, and that's God, truly God, fully God. All right, let's read 19 and 20 together. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ. You got that right? And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. So when I taught this, it was 07 by the time I got to this message, but because I listen to those old messages and go, oh man, am I glad I'm reteaching that. That was a long time ago. I made this big comparison with the New King James, but if you're reading New King James here, that verse 20 is a little like, what? You know? So just read the NLT on the wall. Maybe Aaron will put it back up there for me. Verse 20. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. Let me just kind of get to the root of this. This is saying that the fullness of God in Jesus Christ reconciled all things back to the fullness of God. So I want you to see this compound unity, achad in the Hebrew. It's one made of many. That when we talk about the fullness of God, we're talking about the entire Godhead and the role of Jesus Christ as that Godhead expressed to us in, you know, a tent, a tabernacle of man. The fullness of God reconciled all things back to the fullness of God. Why? Why am I making such a big deal of that? Because there's no other way for you to be reconciled to God than for God to reconcile you to himself. There is no other way. Every single religion structures a system where you can reach God. In fact, that's kind of the definition of religion. Is a way for you to reach God. Let's see, when was that first? What was the Tower of Babel? It was about five? No, it was after the flood. So it's about 10 maybe, Genesis 10? Jacob, you should know this. Anyway, Tower of Babel, first attempt at man's religion, right? Like build a tower to reach God. And religion's been trying to reach God ever since then, but there's no philosophy, there's no ideology, there's no religion that can reconcile us back to God. And so no matter how good an idea, no matter how good a way to live, no matter what kind of suggestions, no matter how family-oriented or whatever it is, it can't do it. Only the fullness of God can reconcile us back to the fullness of God, because nothing else can do it. You'll see more as we go. When I say back, as I said earlier, I mean back to our original state with God, meaning the Adam and Eve state pre-fall. You know that's what God's doing, right? It seems like to us it's like, really? Why, you know, couldn't you just like do the I Dream a Genie thing, like twinkle your nose or what? And pop, you know, make us all go back. Well, if he would have done that the year before you were born, where would you be, right? So so God's just waiting, but he's working, and he's bringing glory to his name. All of the heavenly creation is in awe at what God is doing, but ultimately God is going to return us to a relational status similar to the relational, not similar, exactly, similar to the relational status he had with Adam and Eve, but in glory, right? Which the new earth will be part of, but that's another lesson. The fullness of God in Jesus Christ reconciled man and all creation back to the former state. You see it in verse 20, he reconciled everything, all things. So that's us and the rest of creation. In a practical sense, is that done? I mean, have you checked the news? Okay, I'll just tell you, no, it's not done. Positionally, is that done? It absolutely is. It is finished. And so when Revelation says that Jesus will come quickly, it doesn't mean soon. It means when the clock hits 12, bam, he's going to be here. Could be 2 hours and 15 minutes from now. But at some point when that prophetic clock hits 12, it's going to happen really quickly. And then what is true positionally today will be true practically, tangibly on earth and ultimately in heaven. Quick side note here, because, you know, whatever, people, you know, people. Verse 20 again, through Christ, God reconciled everything. Listen, that doesn't mean everybody gets saved, all right? The universalism thing, you know, like, you know, whatever. Like, I could go into it, but let me just tell you, let me just speak positively. Hey, that's new, Dave. It does not mean that all people are going to be saved. It just doesn't. The offer, but listen to me, please, please, and tell some of your friends that don't understand that JC stands for Jesus Christ, tell them the offer for God to reconcile absolutely all people is 100% clear in the Bible. It is. It is. The Bible is clear that being reconciled is offered to all, but it is only appropriated, it's only received by those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. And so long time ago, 500 or 600 years ago, someone said, you know, I don't think God would die for someone who doesn't receive him, so let's just say he didn't die for them, and let's just, but that's not in the Bible. I don't know, I just, you know, throwing that out. John 3:16 is on the wall. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That's the offer to all people. But then John 3:16, I'm using John 3:16 for a purpose because it's a pretty famous verse. It goes on to say that whoever believes in him. The word whosoever means literally each, every, any, or all. So whether it's one or whether it's all of the world. Whosoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So there's an offer to all people, but we understand that there's a need to receive, to appropriate, to step into what Christ has done through faith. That's being born again. That's putting your faith in Jesus. And Romans 6 says, when you do, you're so identified with Christ that what he's done, you've done. And so when he beat sin, he beat it in your place. And through faith, you being identified with him means that you beat sin. There's no religion that can do that. When he beat death, you beat death. When he rose again, you rose again in him. That's what Romans 6 and really all the New Testament says. So, here's my point in Colossians. There's nothing to compare to Jesus Christ. You just can't. It sounds like real narrow-minded because there's only one God and there's only one Savior and there's only one way for our sin to be dealt with. That's by God dealing with it to reconcile us to himself. So it is narrow-minded, but it's not by choice. If I open this 2,000-year-old supernatural, miraculously proved book and it said all roads lead to heaven, I'd say, well, God says all roads lead to heaven. But we've got an incredibly miraculous, living, supernatural. It cannot be refuted if someone looks at the validity of the Bible, really researches it, and God says this is how it works. So you can believe it or reject it, but you can't change it. Jesus Christ came to earth to make peace between a fallen, sinful world and a holy and just God. You ready to move on to the second half of the second verse? See how this is going? Colossians 1, verse 20b, he made peace. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. When sin entered the world, guys, all of creation was separated from God. Why? Because God is first and foremost holy and just, and no sin can be in his presence. And so when sin came, followed by the curse of sin, there was an immediate crevasse of separation between all of creation and God. The Bible also says that by our sin, we became hostile to God. Just by our nature and by our actions, we're hostile. Romans says we are at enmity. We are at war with God. What Jesus Christ has done in his life and death and his resurrection is to make peace between us and God, to restore that relationship, to restore that standing. And not only between us and God, but the whole fallen world. It's all the world. Look, everything in heaven and on earth, by means of Christ's sacrifice, his blood on the cross, all things, including creation, will be reconciled back to God because of Jesus Christ. And it's really easy to say, you know, like, oh, you know, God's going to make all things right. I mean, most people will agree with you. But when you say by Jesus Christ, and for you to be part of it, there's a need for you to believe that, have faith in Jesus Christ. The road gets narrow. Romans 8:19 is on the wall. You write it in your margin for later when you have this conversation with your Aunt Jeannie. Like, I dream of Jeannie. That was a show, okay? Yeah. And it was in color. It wasn't that long ago. Romans 8. I think it was in color. I don't know. Romans 8, verse 19. It's on the wall. It says, for all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who his children really are. That's when the positional becomes practical. Verse 20 says, against its will, because of the curse of sin, against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse, the curse of sin. But with eager hope, the creation, verse 21, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. Listen, all of creation is waiting for us to be revealed as the sons and daughters of God, because at that time, then the curse will be lifted from creation as well. Is that cool? It's really cool, right? I was gonna make some joke about, you know, nah, I can't. Listen, the world, global warming is going to be fixed, but not by Al Gore and AOC, okay? But it will be fixed. They may or may not be aware of it, but it will be. All right, that's as far as down that road as I can go. Again, Colossians 1:20 says that God made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's sacrifice. But here's the good news today. This is the real good news. It's in verse 21. This includes you. You want to be included in this reconciling of all things. You want to be included. This includes you who were once far away. The word means alienated. You were separated from God. This includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. And this really takes care of the I'm a pretty good person, I think God will let me in thing, right? You got those people in your life? I mean, I'm not one to speak because I've offended a bunch of those people. Might be a surprise to you that I would offend somebody. But somehow let them know, no. You can't be good enough. By nature and by choice, you're a sinner. You can't be in the presence of God with even one sin. You were alienated. It's in the perfect tense, by the way, that far away. You were permanently alienated. There was no way for you to get to God from where you were. You were permanently alienated, separated because of your sin, and you had no possible way to be reconciled to God for eternity. That's where we are without Christ. And not only are we separated from him, but we are his enemies. Romans 8, verse 7 is on the wall. You write it down, just a quick little cross-reference. It says, for our sinful nature is always hostile at enmity. Our sinful nature is always at war with God. And so by your fallen nature and by your actions, you're permanently separated from God. But the fullness of God came because there was no other way. The fullness of God came in the person of Jesus Christ to reconcile you back to himself, back to the fullness of God. He brought you back to that former state of harmony with him. That's where you want to be. That's where you want to be. How did he do it? And what was the result? Colossians 1 verse 22 tells us how he did it. And it gives us just a glimpse, just a quick peek at the result. Colossians 1 22. Yet now he has reconciled you. That's bringing you back to a former state of harmony. He has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. That's the how. It does relate to the particular false teaching that was going on in Colossians. It ultimately became Gnosticism, and they had issues with the whole physical body thing. But unless anybody in a Gnostic cult, all right, so I don't really need to go into that. If you are, call me later. They're out there. I'm telling you, they are. I was going to name somebody. He reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. He's just saying it was real. It was real. God became a real man, 100% God, 100% man. And he reconciled you through his death. As a result, verse 22 continues, second sentence, as a result, he has brought you into his own presence. I don't know if we know the value of being in the presence of God. He's brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless. Some of y'all are like, seriously? Because that's a long way from where I was. You are holy and blameless. Blameless. You're blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. As a result of the fullness of God in the person of Christ, taking on your sin, dying to pay the full penalty of that sin and beating sin and death in the grave, now he brings you into his own presence and he makes you holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. And can I tell you, please, that's the only way you can stand before God. It's the only way. It's the only way. Romans 6:23, you probably haven't memorized, says, for the wages of sin is death. That's what sin does. It brings death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Because, listen, God is first perfectly holy and just, so he can't excuse your sin. If God were to just excuse your sin because you're a good guy or whatever you think, he could no longer be God. That would end his ability to be God because he must be holy, righteous, and just, or he cannot be God. And so your sin has to be dealt with, can't be overlooked. It has to be paid for. And there's no one on earth who could pay the penalty for your sin besides you. And by the way, God does give you the choice to pay for your own sin. Don't pick it. So the fullness of God came in the person of Jesus to pay the full and complete penalty on our behalf and in our place. In fact, you want to write this one down, 2 Corinthians 5:21. Whoo, man. I'm going to go ahead and read it from the NLT, but I always quote it from New King James because, you know, it's always been a pinnacle verse for me. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. New King James, most of the literals say that he made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be our sin. And a little manuscript difference there, but either way is true. He became your sin, and then he paid the full penalty for it, the full wrath of God that you would otherwise pay for eternity. The fullness of God in Jesus Christ paid it for you so that we could be made right. We crossed that line from judgment of God to holy and righteous in God's presence so that you could be made right with God through Christ. So that you could stand in front of God in the righteousness of Christ. Not because you're better than, you know, your dirtbag sibling or whatever. It's not, God isn't great on the curve. You're either in the presence of God or out. And you don't have any way to get in. Only through Jesus Christ can you get in. We're made right with God because the penalty of our sin has been paid in full. Bam, tetelestai, tetelestai. When Jesus cried out, tetelestai on the cross, it is finished. It's a word that is stamped on a debt when it's paid in full. Bam, tetelestai. It's paid in full. You no longer owe the debt. Whoo. And so because Jesus Christ paid that debt in full, it's just as if you paid it yourself. Just as if I'd paid it myself. That's what justified means. It's just as if I would have paid that full debt myself. So here's the deal. Why do we so quickly go after this or that spiritually? Like, oh, well, I heard this. Oh, well, I heard, oh, I this. Oh, you know, because we're shoppers, we're consumers. So it's like, oh, someone's got a new idea. Let me hear what they say. Don't do that, you guys. How can you do that? We don't need a new idea spiritually or some kind of higher spiritual knowledge. Listen, just remember this, please. We need to be reconciled to a holy and righteous and just God. That's what we need. And there's no other way. There's no other system or ideology or religion that can do that. The fullness of God in Jesus Christ came to earth as the reconciler of all things. He took our sin upon himself, even became sin for us, paid the full and complete penalty on the cross, conquered sin because of his perfect life, conquered the grave, and rose again as the pioneer of our resurrection, the first fruits of our resurrection. Woo, man. So that he could present us holy, blameless, and without a single fault. Can you read verse 22 again with me? I know I already read it once. I'm not forgetting. Is it cold? I see some people like feeling a little cold. No? No? Okay, Gregory's fine. The rest of you got to put up with it. No? Is it okay, Stephanie? It is cold. Okay. All right. Well, Jacob's not in the room, but someone else can maybe pop those up a little bit. We expected it to be summer. Sorry. It will be. Listen, I shouldn't do this right in the middle of a message. Oh, my gosh. This is terrible. If I tell you a story, will you come back? Do you know where we're at? Are we talking about God reconciling us to himself? Okay, then let me tell you a story. A guy that we have really kind of a long relationship with, but, you know, but hasn't been, you know, hasn't really been around. He's moved away. His family's moved away. You know, he showed up here, and it's awesome. They're good friends, and so then he called, you know, somehow we got into air conditioning, and so he calls me the next day. He says, "Hey, I got this old unit sitting around. You know, I could probably come out and switch that, give you another air conditioner." I think it was hot in here that day when he was here. And so I'm like, "Bro, you don't got to do that." No, let me do it. Okay, when are you coming? All right. So I meet him down here, and he's pulling a brand new, massive air conditioner out of the back of his truck, still shrink wrapped, that's twice the size of the other two air conditioners we have in here. And I just sit around while he installs it. And it's what I do. So the reason it's cool in here is because God provided a massive air conditioner to keep you guys cool. And of course, he wouldn't let me pay him a penny. So I'm telling you guys, man, if you say, "Well, how is God gonna provide?" You watch. God always provides. Okay, I'm sorry. That just came up because I'm like feeling, I'm like, "Ooh, man, that AC's working." It'll be good next month, I promise you, okay? All right, I have to test you now. What are we talking about? Right, reconciler of all things. Okay, Colossians 1:22 gets back on track. "Yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault." God, as your reconciler, makes you holy and blameless and without even being able to be accused. That without a single fault there in verse 22, it means, it's a weird word, but it means unaccusable. You can't even be accused. That's what the end of Romans chapter 8 is talking about. You know, who will accuse us? Christ is for us. Who can accuse us even? Not even able to be accused. So don't be duped by some other religion or spiritual this or that or some. Listen. Here's something that I was reminded of recently. So like if I offend you and you leave this church, because that's kind of, you know, like what I think, you know, that's why I think everyone leaves, like, "Oh boy." And I say to my wife, "You think I offended him?" She says, "Well, honey, what do you want for dinner?" You know? But if you go to another church, you measure how much they talk about Jesus. Because I've been in churches that don't. And people think they're in a Christian church. Christian means little Christ. But I don't hear the word Jesus. So please don't leave if I offend you, okay? Just go to Jacob. He'll walk you through it. But if you do, make sure you're in a church that talks about Jesus. Because otherwise it's man's religion. There's no power. There's no hope there. Whew. Okay. So don't be duped. Stand firm. Stand firm. Stand firm in your faith in Jesus Christ. And don't drift away from the confidence that you have in Christ. Receive him and then just plant yourself and say, "I will not be moved." Because Colossians 1:23a, our last verse, says, But you must continue to believe this truth. And stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the assurance you received when you heard the good news. Now listen, Paul is worried about the Colossians chasing after this new kind of a metaphysical, what we would call metaphysical thing. But I don't know what your risk is, but I know what God's answer is. So whatever you are tempted to be drawn away to, God says, Continue to believe this truth. Don't drift away. Stand firmly. Hold on to Jesus. Hold on to Jesus. We just graduated another class at CBI, and I don't know why. I don't know why, because you know, whatever. I taught the last class of the year, so it's kind of a thing. I kind of felt special about it. And here's what I did. I did a Winston Churchill on him. You know, I just said, listen, never give up. Whatever comes, never give up. Never give up serving Jesus. Never give up following Jesus. Hold on to Christ and don't give up. And they're like all a little like, oh, why would we ever? Oh, trust me. No, if there's any CBI students, I know you guys didn't say that. But, you know, sometimes like you don't know till it's too late. Like, oh man, the enemy took me out. And it's usually because of something silly. All right, so this is a warning. It's one of these if verses. The NLT, I don't think, does a good job really here in the beginning of verse 23. I think it's a little bit unclear because it sounds like a conditional if, and it's not. So there are two ifs in the Greek, and you don't want me to get into all of it. Just let me tell you, one is conditional, one is assumptive. So one is like if or not. The other one is if indeed, or I assume that. This is the I assume that. Most of the literal translations here say if indeed. It's assumptive. It's Paul assuming the Weist expanded Greek New Testament, which, you know, just grab your copy of that and check in. It says, I don't have a copy of it either. It's on my computer, but it says, assuming indeed that you are adhering to the faith, assuming indeed. So it's if indeed or assuming. It's called a first class condition, and it means I assume this for the sake of argument. Like, in order to make this point, I assume that you will continue to believe this truth, stand firmly, and don't drift away from the assurance. So Paul is giving them the benefit of the doubt, but listen, it's also a warning. It just is. It's a warning. So let me just close with this. And this is a weird, kind of a weird way to close, but I have a little bit more. You guys don't like come up and start doing the emotional stuff yet, because this is pretty technical. I deal with this a lot, right? Like, people have this issue a lot. So the assurance of salvation we see as 100% crystal clear in the Bible. If you are truly saved, you are truly saved. And if you are truly saved, you are truly permanently saved. And there's nothing that can snatch you from this good shepherd's hand. The evidence, one of the evidences of true salvation, is permanence. I won't use the other word, but it's permanence. It's permanence. If you are saved, then you are permanently saved. But if you want to see if you're saved, then see if your salvation's permanent, right? Like, turn around and look at your life and say, you know, is this a fad? Am I just, you know, was I just trying to, you know, whatever? I mean, you know, people, they come and go. They follow Jesus for a while and then they move on. That's not true salvation. True salvation has as one of its primary qualities, characteristics, permanence. We've got to continue in the faith. We've got to come back if we've slipped away. And so in the Bible, like all things that you'll argue about with people who have really big, heavy Bibles, in the Bible there is both the assurance of salvation and a warning about superficial salvation. Okay, let me just say it one more time. In the Bible, it's very clear there is an assurance of true salvation and a warning of superficial salvation. So as it is with most, when most Christians get into arguments, both sides are true. So let me just share with you, if there are two sides to an argument, don't pick one. Just let them ramble and then just go, I don't know. So if I ever do that to you. Right? I mean, that's the way. I don't know. I'm not God. you know? I don't know. All right. Paul says again in 1:23, you must continue to believe this truth, stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the assurance you received when you heard the good news. Paul is not implying that you can be truly saved one day and then not truly saved another day. He's saying, if you're not truly saved, get it. Like get real. Check yourself, right? And if you're not saved, get saved and get truly saved. One of the ways that you can know if the Holy Spirit truly has permanent residence in you is that it's really hard to walk away. Like, you know, Holy Spirit tends to tighten the leash up a little bit. Like, whoa, 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 where are you going? And we're like, you know. You know what I'm saying? So what if you've already drifted away? Does that mean you're not saved? I don't know. I don't know if you're saved or not, but I know you should be. I know you should be. So here's the best news that I always tell people when they say, I don't know if I'm saved or not. I'm like, well, you know, I don't mean to overstate the obvious, but why don't we get you saved now? Right? Like, let's just get you saved. And then let's get you plugged in to know Jesus and get you discipler and help you know him better and better. And so here's the thing. If you're not sure if you're saved, if you have that permanent, you know, assurance of salvation, then thank God you're still, you know, on this side of the ground, you know, you're still standing up. Because you can still be saved. So don't question it, just get some. I would say to you in closing, if you want to turn there, you can, because these are the famous verses, and I have the 15 seconds to let you turn there. Turn over to 2 Corinthians 5, and I will let God speak to close the message. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Chapter 5, verse 19. It'll be on the wall too. It says, for God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassador. We see ourselves as Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. Be reconciled. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, it's a good day. It's a good day to come back to you. It's a good day to ask you to come into our lives for the first time. It's a good day to trust you, Lord. Today is the day of salvation, Lord. And we thank you that you, Jesus, are the reconciler of all things, Lord. And not a person here or watching or listening that is beyond your ability to reconcile. And so, Lord, I pray that you would bring us back, restore us, Lord, to harmony with you. If that's you today, I just want to give you a chance to pray. We're about to take communion. And so I want you right now, if you will, wrestle with that and say, Lord, I need to make sure. I need to make sure. I need to know you. So you pray. You pray a prayer like this. Lord Jesus, I believe. I believe you are who you say you are. I believe you've done what you say you've done. I pray that you would forgive me of all of my sin, that you would come into my life, and that you would reconcile me to yourself. that I may be found standing in your presence, holy and blameless and literally unaccusable. Please do that in my life, Lord. And please fill me with your Spirit and draw me into a deeper relationship with you. I pray all these things in your mighty name, Jesus. Amen.